Hi everyone, welcome to the second lecture of Multilingual Natural Language Processing. Today we are going to talk about linguistic typology, the space of languages, and how can we define computationally similarities between languages. So we discussed in the first lecture about the huge linguistic diversity of the world. There are more than 7,000 languages, but also there are thousands of language varieties. For example, Shanghai Singlish. Singlish is an English-based language spoken in Singapore. Singlish mixes English, Mandarin, Tamil, Malay, and other local dialects. And Singlish has unique grammar. The grammar of Singlish is different from the grammar of English or the grammar of Mandarin. And when we want to build an NLP technology, we want to be able to provide it also to the speakers of Singlish, which constitute millions of people. Another example of large linguistic diversity and the hundreds of resource-poor languages are the languages of India. So in India, there are more than 400 languages and there are billions of speakers, but there is not a single resource-rich language. Hindi, as other Indian languages, are still resource-poor. Next example is African languages. In Africa alone, there are around 2,000 languages. These 2,000 languages are spoken by 1.33 billion of people, but all of the African languages are resource poor. To summarize, large amounts of training data are unavailable for most languages. An extreme case is languages that don't have a written form. For example, Shanghainese, spoken by 14 million people, or languages that just don't have any online presence. For example, Chichewa, Bantu language spoken by 12 million people. Overall, 40% of world's population do not have access to machine translation, dialogue system, summarization, and other NLP technologies that could be on par with English or French ones. And NLP technologies is a key to the internet. They can provide people with access to education, to communities. They can be used to monitor democratic processes. They can be used to perform search and translation, and there are many applications that can be provided for future internet users. Okay, so what do we do? A naive attempt to collect the data would be to collect manually data for each individual resource poor language. So we can pick Swahili and try to construct resources in Swahili that are on par with English. A huge parallel corpora to build machine translation, recording to build speech recognition, build tree bank, and so on. Obviously, we all understand that this is prohibitively expensive and probably not feasible because such a huge effort is not only very expensive, but also it requires access to speakers and also a lot of time. So earlier research developed unsupervised approaches. Approaches that reveal hidden structures within unlabeled text data, for example, unsupervised dependency parser or unsupervised grammar induction. But it was shown pretty quickly that the performance of purely unsupervised approaches is not on par. It's relatively lower compared to solutions that use some data or some data from other languages. So another class of approaches that is we could use to provide solutions for low resource NLP is cross-lingual transfer learning approaches. So in cross-lingual transfer learning, we train a model for resource poor language, but we use resources or models from resource rich language. For example, we can transfer annotations, we can build a word or phrase alignments, and this would serve as bridges between resource rich and resource poor language. And we can project annotations from resource rich language, for example, annotations from of part of speech tags. We can project part of speech tags into resource poor language. Another option is to transfer models, to train a model in resource rich language and to adapt it, to fine tune it, or to use it as is in resource poor language. And all of these approaches would require us to ask a question: how do we choose a source language from which we transfer resources? And this is the primary question that we are going to answer in this lecture. What does it mean to select resources from a similar language, and how to define similarities between languages? A similar challenge is opposed to another class of approaches, which are multilingual approaches. So unlike transfer learning approaches that utilize resources from source language to and adapt them to target models, in a joint training or multilingual approaches, we concatenate resources, corpora for across languages, and build a single computational analyzer. And then we would ask a question: which data sets would we want to pick to build a multilingual model? Should we use two data sets or many data sets? Should we use similar languages or different languages? So these questions we will discuss later in the course, and today we'll only focus on the concept of similarity between languages as defined by linguistic typology or other similarity measures. Okay, so we have posted a reading that summarizes large parts of this lecture, choosing transfer languages for cross-lingual learning. The point that we are going to discuss today is, in general, it is not always clear a priori what transfer language to choose. For example, if we want to train an entity linking system for Korean, maybe Chinese training data would be much more useful than French data, because although Chinese and Koreans are different languages and they use different scripts, Korean borrowed massively words from Chinese. So there is a proportion of Korean vocabulary that is borrowed loan words from Chinese. So there is a significant lexical overlap, and maybe an entity linking system or some semantic application, Chinese would be a good transfer language for Korean. For another task, for example, for syntactic task, Turkish might be a better transfer language into Korean, because although these languages are very different, they come from different families, they share syntactic properties. And this and syntactically, these are actually very, and structurally, these are very similar languages. In general, it is not clear a priori which transfer language to use. And what we discuss next is several options on how to choose a similarity. And the paper that we recommended to read has a systematic exploration of these similarity measures. Okay, so how to define similarity across languages? So the first, the most naive approach would be to look at lexical correspondence. So we would simply pick vocabularies with a large lexical overlap with the target language. And by the way, I don't remember if I mentioned it before, the terminology that we would use is the low resource language for which we build resources, we call it target language, and the language from which we borrow resources would be called a transfer language. So our transfer language could be chosen by the size of lexical overlap with the target language. Of course, this simple solution could work if the writing system of the target language is the same as the transfer language. For example, Russian and Ukrainian use similar but not the same scripts. So Russian could be a good transfer language for Ukrainian in some tasks, for example, in machine translation. If we build a system for Marathi, however, which similarly to many Indian and Nepalese languages uses the Devanagari script, we could use Hindi as a transfer language. But unfortunately, the majority of NLP tasks, even for Hindi, are still considered as resource poor, underperforming tasks. So the similarity is defined by lexical overlap is very restrictive. Next simple option is to define the similarity by the geographical distance. So there is a website called glottolog.org that summarizes a lot of information about languages. This is one of the websites that we will link in these slides, and there will be several more useful websites in which you can read a lot about the diversity, the varieties of language. So glottolog defines the primary location of a language. So if we want to use similarity, we can look at the closest language, for example, to this one. Of course, this measure has a lot of drawbacks, especially if you think about the English languages like Portuguese. There are many varieties of Portuguese, for example, Brazilian Portuguese and European Portuguese. So it is not always clear how to pick the similar language by just geographic diversity. And also there are neighboring countries that have very different languages. Okay, the next approach can be, we can look at demographic similarity. When languages are classified in terms of the demographics, for example, the size of the population, communicative situations in which the language is used, and so forth. So importantly, all these are plausible options, but not as useful as the next one. So the next option would be to, a more practically useful option is to pick languages and to quantify similarity between languages by looking at phylogenetic similarity or genealogical similarity. So this slide lists 13 language families. These are largest language families that each family covers at least 1% of the 7,000 known languages in the world. And this information is extracted from the Ethnologue website. So historically, languages within language families share a lot of common features. So this would be a reasonable choice to look at genealogical similarity to pick a transfer language. However, languages within a single family could also differ a lot, specifically due to language change over time. So language, as I mentioned, can be neighboring to a very different language. And then when two communities of diverse languages come into contact, they start borrowing words from one language to another, and then sister languages diverge into and start to acquire different properties. This is why genealogical similarity is a good option, but not the best option to use to define similarity between languages. Okay, so we come to the topic of this talk is the typological similarity between languages. So yet another approach in which was found the most effective in most but not all transfer learning studies is to focus on the linguistic similarity according to the language typology. So whereas genealogical similarity or phylogenetic similarity between languages is studied by historical linguists, and it studies the language change over time, so diachronic change of language. typological similarity is studied by linguistic typologists. Linguistic typology is the classification of languages according to their functional and structural properties. It explains common properties across languages and also explains structural diversity across languages. So this is a definition of language typology taken from the Bailey's introductory book. The classification of languages or components of languages based on shared formal characteristics. So crucially, typology is a systematic study and a comparative study, which studies languages comparatively. So it's not enough to study typological properties or structural features of language in isolation. A typology always studied takes dozens of languages and compares them and finds common properties. So linguistic typology can classify specific properties of languages, and then it can classify languages as a whole. Okay, so here is one example of linguistic typology focusing on phonology. So what we see is the International Phonetic Alphabet, IPA, which allows us to describe sounds accurately. And here we see the mapping of the space of all consonants that people can pronounce across languages. So so phonologists analyzed hundreds of languages, and based on the just what is possible for a person to pronounce based on the manner of pronunciation and place of articulation, we define the space of consonants. And in this table, we can see consonants, but also we can see that there are properties that are shared across languages and the properties that are different between languages. For example, if you look at Arabic consonants, there are consonants here that are in Arabic but not in French, and there are consonants that are in French but not in Arabic, and there are consonants that are shared between Arabic and French. So the goal of typology is to map variation and understand the dimensions of variation, and it can help us understand how similar and how different the languages can be. So another interesting example, which is taken from WALS, the World Atlas of Language Structures Online. And here is the URL specifically to this example, is the map that shows the distribution of how people use numerals across languages, how people use numbers across languages. So English uses the decimal numerical system. So when we talk, we use numerals with the base of 10. And we can see that the majority of languages in the world use numerals with a base of 10. But there are other languages, for example, red dots. There are red dots. They correspond to, I don't know if you can see it, but the red dots correspond to the base of 20. And then there are other languages that have very different numeral systems. For example, the yellow dots here. The yellow dots correspond to languages that use body parts, which correspond to numbers. So instead of saying a number, they would name a part of a body. And the World Atlas of Linguistic Structures, WALS, categorizes across languages, across hundreds of languages, what are possible ways to use a number. And this is only one feature in WALS. This is a feature 131A. It is called numeral basis. Okay, so WALS is the largest typological database. It was constructed by a team of 55 linguists. It currently covers over 2,500 languages from over 200 language families. And it has 192 attributes called typological categories. Here are some examples from the paper of Georgi, Shia and Lewis 2010 that explored this paper explored which type of similarity between languages is better, genealogical similarity or typological similarity. So here is a table that shows some examples of features in rows. So this column ID shows the feature number. This is entry. Then we have a feature name. Okay, so for example, feature 81 talks about the order of subject, object, and verb in the sentence. So is this SVO language or SOV or VSO and so forth. And this category is it corresponds to a category of typological features that describe the word order in a sentence. And it can take 17 possible values. So there are 17 possible ways in which subject, object, and verb can appear in a sentence. And possible values can include SVO, SOV, no dominant order, VSO, VOS, and so on. So as you can see, such a collection of an analysis across 2000 languages, across multiple attributes, it is a huge manual effort. What happens in practice is that typologists gather cross-linguistic data on many languages. And they typically start from 30 to 50 languages, and then they move to several hundreds of languages. And ideally, these languages represent some unbiased sample of languages that needs to capture as much linguistic variation as possible, but also to control for genealogical and geographical bias. Then, to identify the properties of a language, typologists rely on descriptive grammars, for example, on books describing how a language works. And also they consult with native speakers, they use questionnaires, they use surveys, and the raw texts to obtain and analyze data. So again, you can see this is a huge manual effort from which we can extract distributional high-level properties of languages. And it is clear that we can represent the world's database as a two-dimensional matrix with languages along one dimension and features, all the possible features, along another dimension. And as you can see in this example, this matrix is very sparse. A lot of values are missing. It is impossible to analyze all possible features for all possible languages. In fact, in a survey that I will link later, a survey written in 2019, it finds that there are only 17% of the cells in this matrix, typological matrix, are filled. Even well-studied languages could have many empty cells in walls. And the data sparsity of walls is or other typological databases is a serious problem to accurately clustering languages by typological similarity. So there is an active research on how to predict missing features in typological databases. Typically, people use walls as a training data from walls as a training data, and also a subset of a held out subset of features and the entries from walls is used for evaluation. And methods for automatic prediction of typological features focus on annotation projection, for example, finding languages with best aligned syntactic trees and projecting features from these languages. And all kinds of learning methods are used, from unsupervised, from hierarchical clustering methods, to to label propagation, matrix completion, and supervised learning approaches, and also distributional approaches. So these methods are important because it is infeasible, again, to fill the huge space of typological properties of language, which basically can describe how each language works. But there are notable drawbacks in these methods. So the drawback is that to complete the matrix, people use approaches, as I mentioned, transfer learning approaches, when to identify other language, they look for other languages which have similar properties and make projection. How would they look for other languages that have similar properties? Typically, people resort to looking at languages from the same language family. So they kind of mix the genealogical information and typological information. In this way, the manually identified values in the walls are trustworthy, and they are often different from feature descriptions in compared to phylogenetic information. But predicted values are very similar to genealogical information. Okay, so I mentioned walls as one of the typological databases. So this survey paper by Ponti et al., published in Computational Linguistics in 2019, Modeling Language Variation in Universals, it provides a very nice comprehensive summary of other typological databases. And I'm showing here a screenshot from this survey, and I don't expect you to see it, but I expect you to actually take a look at the survey and hopefully read it. Some examples of the typological databases, in addition to walls that I mentioned, for example, let's say, World Longbone database. So if we are looking for typological properties that are related to semantic similarities between languages, we can use the BOLD databases that analyzes what words were borrowed and transferred across languages. Another example would be FOIBLE. I actually don't see this in this list, but I'm sure, here it is, FOIBLE. So this is a phonological database. So FOIBLE is a typological database that specifically describes, focuses on phonological properties across languages. And practically what you can use is the URL database, which was actually constructed at CMU. It is was constructed by Pat Littell, David Mortensen, and Laurie Levin. This is a combination, a compendium, or just a combination of all existing typological data sets that combine phonology, morphosyntax, lexical semantic features of languages. It has a very broad coverage, more than 8,000 languages with around 300 attributes. And basically it is a merged database of other databases. And then Graham Newbig's team focused on constructing on developing approaches to filling in the missing entries in this typological matrix, and they incorporated it into Lang2Vec toolkit, which basically a very convenient, flexible toolkit in which you can extract typological vectors or language family vectors with binary features or language vectors with continuous features, and you can also incorporate feature prediction algorithms to estimate missing values. So if you want to, in your project, if you want to extract typological vectors, I would recommend to use Lang2Vec. It would be the easiest. Okay, so the term of language typology goes hand in hand with an important other concept of language universals. So language universals concept is related to the goal. Why typologists are constructing language typologies. And the goal is to identify unique properties that hold for most for all human languages. And by identifying language universals, linguists can better approach the ultimate question of linguistics: what constitutes a language? And they can better annotate newly discovered languages. So simple examples of language universals would be that every language has vowels and consonants. Another example of language universals is that all or nearly all languages of the world make a distinction between nouns and verbs. In contrast, an example of something that is not universal across languages is the presence of adjectives. For example, Chinese and most languages in Southeast Asia make no formal distinction between adjectives and verbs. In most Indo-European languages, adjectives are a separate class. And adjectives have more in common with nouns than with verbs. In Japanese, there are two types of adjectives, one with noun-like features and another with verb-like features. Okay, so another topic that we will discuss in the future is how linguistic typology is actually used to transfer sources. I mentioned several times that we could use these vectors to pick most similar language, but then how to incorporate these vectors into the multilingual models. And again, we can use it through annotation projection, model transfer, or joint or translation or joint modeling. But these are the topics that we will discuss in the next few lectures of our course. Okay, what are open research problems in the space of linguistic typology, in the intersection of linguistic typology and NLP? First is how to extract typological features automatically from existing multilingual resources. So there are several resources that are massively multilingual. For example, universal dependency tree bank, Unimorph, Wikipedia, or Bible corpora. And in principle, we could instead of trying to project or to use matrix completion to predict typological features, we could extract typological features from those resources. Another open research problem is how to accurately predict typological knowledge, but to demote the bias of genealogical and aerial features. Next, how to incorporate linguistic typology into models. And in the future, we will talk about various existing approaches, but the space is not solved. And a very interesting, more new question is, if we have a massively multilingual models and we mix resources, how do we make sure that to prevent or alleviate negative transfer or catastrophic forgetting, how do we make each individual language in the multilingual model perform on par with its monolingual model counterpart, or even better than a monolingual model? Okay, future readings. It would be nice if you could read the survey if you are interested in this topic. It is a comprehensive and interesting survey, but it is not compulsory for the course. If you want to read more than this survey, there are a bunch of papers in general ACL conferences and several relevant workshops. For example, SIGMORPHON, SIGTYPE, ComputeL, Africa NLP, DeepLaw, and so on. For the class reading for Thursday, you will need to read the paper, Choosing Transfer Languages for Cross-Lingual Learning. And here is a discussion question. So, do you speak a resource-poor language? If yes, pick this language. If not, pick the language that is called Tigrinya. How do you know this is a resource-poor language? For example, you can check if this language has a fast text embeddings of all it has a machine translation system in Google Translate. If not, it is likely a very resource-poor language. Okay, for this language of your choice, Tigrinya or another one, try to think, what language could be a good transfer language for your target language? For example, what could be a good transfer language if you need to build a machine translation system? Would your answer change before and after reading this paper? After reading this paper, would your intuition of what is a good transfer language, would it change? Also, if you would need to implement a syntactic task, for example, a part of speech tagging, what would be a good transfer language for this language? Also, if you would need to implement a sentiment analysis, so a semantic task, would your answer change? So in general, try to understand the typology, the relationship, the language family relationship of this language, and based on this, predict what could be a good transfer language for the low resource language that we choose. Okay. Thank you, everyone, and see you in the next class.